Hello everyone, welcome to online lecture week 2, and our topic is energy conversion engineering. In our previous class we discussed about our syllabus and what are the topics we are going to discuss in this lecture, and also we discussed about the basics of nanoscience and nanotechnology in the field of supercapacitors. This week we will discuss the second week topic. Once again, welcome to the online class, second week. As you all know, this is our syllabus. In this top, actually our lecture belongs to the supercapacitors. Supercapacitors used for energy storage devices. So before going to discuss about supercapacitors, we need to understand about energy related issues. What are the energy resources available to us, natural resources or artificial resources, and how it is available in our environment, and how can we convert the energy from one form to another form, and how we can store the energy. We need to know all the energy related topics before going to discuss about supercapacitors. It may look to be very fundamental, but it is essential to know all the related topics related to supercapacitors. So in this lecture we need to discuss about the fundamental terms, fundamental information related to the energy and environment and energy conversion and storage, so that we can enter into the topic of supercapacitors in our coming lectures. This slide gives the information of how much energy is required and how much energy we are utilizing from our day-to-day life. From this figure, we can understand the drastic increase of the energy requirement. From the graph, we can understand that from the 19th century, a large increase in energy use in industrial, and also for industrial purpose, most of the times we are using coal. Homes and other buildings were heated. Factories and railways were powered by the steam engines. Mining and chemical industries developed, and agriculture also we are using energy, which became more machines we are using for agriculture. The emergence of technological societies in the 20th century resulted in an even larger increase in energy use for manufacturing, agriculture, transport, and a host of other applications. In technologically advanced countries, the largest increases have been in using gas for heating, oil products for transport, and electricity as a convenient means of transferring energy generated by a variety of sources. Also, we have many types of energies available around us. For example, you can see here potential energy, kinetic energy, thermal energy, radiant energy, chemical energy, nuclear energy. Here you can also see the examples for the various energy types. For potential energy, the example is hydro energy. Here, this hydro energy we can get from many dams. We can store the water at dams, and we are using this water to generate energy, electrical energy like that. Also, we can use a kinetic energy, for example, wind energy. So we can observe very, very big fan type structures for capturing wind energy. And also we can get from ocean waves, tidal waves, by using some mechanical equipment. We can acquire the kinetic energy from the oceans also. And also from geothermal and ocean thermal, we can get thermal energy. And the one of the familiar energy we are using nowadays is solar energy. This radiant energy, we are capturing most of solar energy by using solar panels to many applications. And also we are using oil. Oil means here we can understand it is petrol or diesel. We are using coal, gas, biomass. These are all chemical energies which are highly useful in our day-to-day lives. And also we are using nuclear energy, which we are getting from nuclear power plants. So many countries are equipped with nuclear energy because it is very cheap, even though it has many difficulties, but most of the countries are interested to use nuclear energy because it can produce large amount of energy with cheaper price, where we are using uranium and thorium. So these are the kinds of energies and the examples.
Slide 3.
Here are some very clear details about the different kinds of energies and the chemical energy. This energy can be produced from fossil fuels such as coal, petroleum, and biofuels such as wood are the products of conversion of solar energy into the energy of chemical combination through photosynthesis by plants. The second one is nuclear energy. Nuclear fuels are heavy radioactive isotopes produced by thermonuclear fusion in long dead stars that became supernova and followed geothermal energy. It comes from heat produced by natural decay of radioactive isotopes distributed at very low concentrations in the earth. Geothermal energy, usually it's not a major energy that we are using in our everyday activities or industry needs, but here we are using most energy in our future energy, that is solar energy. Solar energy is emitted by thermonuclear fusion within the sun. So this solar energy is captured by solar cells, and we can further use this energy into our industrial purposes. And there are some minor energies, that is tidal energy. It is essentially the work done by the gravitational fields of the moon and sun on the oceans. And also wind and wave energy are solar energy converted into work done by the earth's atmosphere and oceans. Hydro energy, this is one of the major energies that we are using in our activities. Hydro energy relies on work done by the solar energy in evaporating water that falls as a rain or snow at high topographic elevations, which in turn has gravitational potential energies. We discussed about the different kinds of energies in our previous slide also. So many energies are available. Even though we have many kinds of energies, majorly we are depend on some only few energy types like solar energy, wind energy, chemical energy, nuclear energy. The mankind is not much depends on the tidal energies, geothermal energies like that. This chart gives us the amount of different sectors of energies we are using in our daily lives. Usually, the major contribution of energy type is oil. That means this petrol, diesel kinds of energies. Generally, global annual consumption of all forms of primary energy increased more than tenfold during the 20th century. From the chart, we can observe the different contributions of various energy sources to global energy consumption. From this chart, the major is oil and followed by coal, natural gas and nuclear, large hydro, traditional biomass and other renewable energy sources. Oil related energy sources is around 32.6% and coal is 22.2%, natural gas 21.1%, traditional biomass 10.6%, nuclear 5.7%, and hydro related energy is 5.5%, and other renewable energies are 2.3%. So from this chart clearly gives we are majorly depends on three sectors, that is oil, coal, natural gas. Actually, other renewable energies, solar energy comes under this category. Might be in future we will energy consumption of solar energy will increase, because coal is it's a limited availability. So as we use more natural resources like coal, so it will end after some time. So as the solar energy utilization increases, then automatically this renewable energy percentage of energy will increase more. Also, the nuclear energy is one of the major energies. Even in South Korea, we have many nuclear power plants. So likewise, in many major countries are depending on nuclear energy, because it gives a very huge amount of energy for the many purposes. So one of the, even now today we are using more nuclear energies, even in future we will use more nuclear energy, because the daily activities, that means industrial or any energy requirement, is going to be more in future. So the mankind majorly depends on nuclear energy and solar energy. So far we have discussed about energy resources, and from now we will discuss about energy conversion. We all know the energy can be converted from one form to another form. So energy is present in many forms all around us, such as electrical, kinetic, thermal, potential, and various other forms. There is also energy in the process of transfer from one body to another, that is heat and work. This simple diagram is explain us about energy conversion from one form to another form. So basically we need to supply one energy, and the devices or the technologies will convert from one form of energy into useful form of energy. And this useful form of energy depends on our requirement, which kind of energy we need. So based on the output energy type, we need a separate or individual technologies which can transform from one form of energy into another form of energy. In the present technology field, we have many technologies which will convert into different kinds of output energies. So depends on the output energy, we need to select the technology which is convert one form of energy into our required format of energy. Coming to the conversion efficiency, even though we have different kinds of conversion processes or technologies to convert one form of energy into another form of energy, we could not convert 100% energy from one form to another form. In the process of energy conversion, we have two kinds of outputs. That is, one output which is majorly we can use as output, and in the process of conversion we will find some energy loss, and in many processes the energy loss will be in the form of heat. So this heat energy is mostly can be treated as energy loss. So how this energy efficiency depends is mostly belongs to the amount of energy loss. If we have less energy loss, we have more efficiency. So the conversion efficiency depends on the energy loss amount. This slide clearly gives us the energy sources and also conversion processes. Usually from our previous slides, we came to know and understood the energy sources. From the bottom, we can observe fossil fuels, which are the natural resources of energy from our environment, that is gas, oil, and coal. So these energy sources will be used to make chemical energy and nuclear energy. And also from the top of the figure, we can observe the energy sources which are related to solar energy. From the solar energy, we can make or we can prepare different kinds of energies, which are biomass fuels and ocean thermal related energies, that is tidal energies like that. And also we can make from by using solar cells like photovoltaics, and also due to the climate, that means from the wind energy, hydro energy, waves, tidal related energies. So from the top and bottom of the figure, we can see many kinds of energy sources, from fossil fuel to and solar energy related energies. Fossil fuels are limited availability in our earth, but solar is almost unlimited energy. So solar energy is most renewable energies. Okay, from these energy sources, how we are converting these basic energy sources into useful? So from the middle of the figure, you can observe this chemical and nuclear energies which are converted into heat energy, and this heat energy can be directly used to some applications, or this heat energy will be converted into mechanical work, and this mechanical work can be used for some purposes directly. We can use, or we can convert again the mechanical energy into electrical energy. This electrical energy can be used for different purposes. So here, from heat energy and from mechanical work or mechanical energy or from electricity, we can find the end applications or uses. We can use this energy to the residential purposes, industrial purposes, and for transportation purposes. So this chart gives a clear idea of availability of energy resources and how the energies are converted, and how the converted energy, that means the output energy, will be useful to different purposes of our daily life. That means for residential purpose, for home purpose, for industrial purpose, and transportation purposes. So here you can see the bottom energy sources are non-renewable energies, that is fossil fuels, that is gas, oil, and coal. And the top of the chart gives the information related to the renewable energy. So that is means we can say that it is everlasting energy, that is solar energy. So from these two kinds of renewable and non-renewable energies, we can find chemical energy and nuclear energy, which can produce heat, which can leads to the mechanical energy and electrical energy. Finally, we can find very purposeful output energy. Here are the energy conversion devices, and we can give the energy input as one kind of energy, and we will find another kind of energy as output. It depends on the energy conversion. The selection of energy conversion device depends on the input energy and output energy. So here are a list of energy conversion devices which convert one kind of energy into another kind of energy. Here I am reading one by one. See it clearly. Electric heater. So here these are all the basic energy conversion devices. So I am reading one by one. Electric heater. So it converts electricity into thermal energy. So for electric heater, we need to give electricity, that means current, as energy input, and it converts this electricity into thermal energy as output. The second one is hair dryer. So it converts electricity into thermal energy. It almost do the same purposes, the electricity into thermal energy. Electric generator converts mechanical energy into electricity. Electric motor. It is an energy conversion device which convert electricity into mechanical energy. Battery is one of the energy storage device which converts the energy of chemical energy into electricity. So our topic supercapacitor is also belongs to this kind, which converts chemical energy into electricity. Next, steam boiler. It converts chemical energy into thermal energy. Next, furnace. Furnace is also an energy conversion device which converts chemical energy into thermal energy. Steam turbine. It converts thermal energy into mechanical energy. Gas turbine. It converts, it needs chemical energy and it converts mechanical energy. Automobile engine. It needs chemical energy and it converts, the output is mechanical energy. Fluorescent lamp. Input is electricity, output is light. Silicon solar cell. Input is solar energy, output electricity. Steam locomotive. Energy input chemical, energy output mechanical. Incandescent lamp. Energy input electricity and output is light. So these are all the common energy conversion devices. So we need to understand that an energy conversion device or the selection of energy conversion device depends on the energy input and energy output. So these are all common energy conversion devices which convert one form of energy into another form of energy. This table gives the information of conversion efficiencies. So here are some energy conversion technologies, and it converts which type of energy into which type of energy, and how much is the approximate efficiencies. These are all not the exact efficiencies, but it is the range of efficiencies of the individual conversion technologies. If you consider natural gas furnace, it converts chemical energy into heat energy. It gives the efficiency of 90% to 96%. Internal combustion engine. This energy conversion technology converts chemical energy into mechanical energy with efficiency in the range of 15% to 25%. Power plant boilers. It converts chemical energy into heat energy with efficiency in the range of 90% to 98%. Steam turbines. This conversion technology converts heat energy into mechanical energy with efficiency 40% to 45%. Electric generator. It converts mechanical energy into electrical energy, that means electricity, with percentage of 98% to 99%. It gives highest efficiency conversion technology. Gas turbines. It converts chemical energy into mechanical energy with efficiency of 35% to 40%. Hydro conversion technology converts gravitational potential energy into mechanical energy with efficiency of 60% to 90%. Geothermal conversion technology converts thermal energy into mechanical, and it leads to finally electricity with efficiency of 6% to 13%. Wind energy converts kinetic energy into mechanical energy and finally electricity with efficiency 30% to 60%. And photovoltaic cells, so which where we use sunlight as energy source, that is radiation, and it converts into electricity with a percentage of 10% to 15%. And finally, ocean thermal conversion technology. It converts
thermal energy into mechanical and finally into electricity with efficiency percentage of 1 to 3%. Among all the conversion technologies which are showing in this chart, the maximum percentage or maximum conversion efficiency is for electric generators, and lowest is ocean thermal efficiency. Coming to the energy storage technology, modern technology is already providing us with such alternatives like wind turbines, photovoltaic cells, biomass plants, and more. But these technologies have some drawbacks and have some problems for its efficiency for the long term basis. Compared to traditional power plants, they produce much smaller amounts of electricity, and even more problematic is the inconsistency of the production. The global demand for electricity is huge, and it's growing by approximately 3.6% annually. But the sun is not always shining, nor is the wind always blowing. We could not have sun all the time. We could not have wind all the time. For such a technical reasons, however, the amount of electricity fed into the power grid must always remain on the same level as demanded by the consumers to prevent blackouts and damage to the grid. It leads to the situations where the production is higher than consumption or vice versa. This is where energy storage technologies come into play. They are the key element to balance out these problems. With the growing importance of renewable energy sources, scientists, researchers, engineers are interested to improve the efficiencies and to decrease the cost of these technologies. Yet, there seems to be only a handful of technologies, some of the technologies available that are efficient enough and also economical. Storing energy is not an easy task, as most of us know it. Our smartphone battery only lasts for about a day, or laptops works for some few hours. The range of electric cars is limited only little more than 100 kilometers, like that. That means we have more limitations of efficiencies, and these are only examples for comparatively small devices. Now imagine the problem of storing energy at the level of hundreds to thousands of wind turbines and photovoltaic cells. It is extremely difficult. So we need to improve the efficiency of the available and efficient technologies which are available to us. Electrical power usually starts at power plants. Although it may be coal, gas, or even nuclear power, almost every conventional plant produces electrical energy through steam-powered turbines. The fossil fuels are burned in order to make water boil and turn into steam, which then enters the turbines and pushes against blades to turn the generator shaft to create electric current. Right after the turbine, the steam is usually cooled down and turned into liquid form again in order to increase efficiency. So this is the schematic diagram of how the steam produced, how the turbine rotates and generates the electricity. This is the schematic diagram. This is the basic diagram of power generation and transmission. Coming to the transmission and distribution, power plants are not located very near to our houses, but they tend to have sites where noise and and it is where we need to construct these power plants where the population is minimum. And to transport electricity from plants to the locations where we need to supply, we need an electrical grid. Coming to the power supply point of view, we have several categories of power grids, especially extra high voltage grid, distribution grid, low voltage grid. So depends on the electricity which we are going to transfer, is the voltages higher than 220 kilovolts. In order to keep energy losses to a minimum when transporting over long distances, we need to construct extra high voltage grid. These lines can run hundreds to thousands of kilometers and deliver the power into common grid, but are also used for translational exchange. So for this purpose, we need to construct extra high voltage grid. The second one is high voltage grid. Transformer stations transform the power to lower voltages, usually between 60 and 220 kV. These lines are supposed to carry electricity into different regional areas with high population density or bigger industrial areas. So high voltage grids can be located in to closer to the cities where we need to supply electricity. And the third is distribution grid. The voltages between 6 kV to 60 kV. The main task of this distribution grid is to provide major institutions like facilities, schools, hospitals, and transformer stations. These transformer stations are responsible for low voltage grids delivering to provide household purposes. And the last is low voltage grid. So it can also be known as low voltage grid between 110 volt to 400 volt are common. The low voltage grid is the last station of the transmission and provide private households with power to use for everyday electronic devices. So depends on the distance and the requirement of the place for the electricity, we need to make different kinds of grids to supply the electricity from power plants. One of the energy storage technology is pumped storage hydroelectricity. Pumped hydro plants So far, it is considered to be the only possible way to store energy in a huge amount while maintaining a high efficiency and being economical as well as it gives a most efficient energy storage technology. And these kind of pumped storage hydroelectricity technology was planned very in 1890s, in 1900s. So the concept is old, but it gives high efficiency for storage the energy. And the concept is very simple. We all know the concept of this storage in at the dams. So the simple concept is when you lift an object of a certain mass, you overcome the gravity. In order to do, you must supply a force over a height. So in order to lift a body or water, we need to apply a physical force required to lift the heavy weighted water. This work meaning the energy supplied and therefore stored in the object where we placed at certain height. So how can we estimate the energy we stored there? It is simple. The energy stored equals to the mass multiplied by the gravity and height. So in this way we can store energy at a certain height. So the energy depends on how much water we stored and at what height we stored the water. So it gives the energy stored at certain height. Basically, the system contains two water reservoirs at different elevations. In times of low electricity demand and high production, water is pumped from the lower reservoir into the higher, storing the electricity in the water in the form of potential energy. We needed, for example, on the peak demand where we need more energy, the water can be released flowing down the pipes again and back through the turbine, which then generates the electricity. Depending upon the height difference and by using turbines, we can maximize the efficiency, and the efficiency is very high in this technology. It is about 90%. These turbines are reversible and therefore capable of handling both the pumping and generating process. And coming to the positives and negatives of this technology, is we can observe here positives and negatives. So it is a very good technology capable of storing huge amounts of energy. It can give more energy. We are able to store more amount of water at heights due to the dams, so that we can produce huge amount of energy. And second advantage is high overall efficiency. It gives the overall efficiency around 70 to 80%, and also we can produce very fast energy by this technology. So fast response times, and when compared to other energy storage technologies, it is very inexpensive. So inexpensive way to store energy. Similar to the advantages, there are some disadvantages for this technology, because in order to store water at dams is not possible at all the places. So at certain points, at certain places only, we can build such a large and height dams. So the place is very we could not find all the places, and also it has huge environmental impacts, because in order to build a very height dam, so we need to sacrifice some place around the rivers or somewhere the water we are going to store. And also it requires a significant huge water source like rivers, like that. One of the energy storage technology is superconducting magnetic energy storage. This technology is a little expensive, yet we need to know the superconducting technology. The concept of this technology is, the system consists of three major components: the coil, the power conditioning system, PCS, and a cooling system. The idea is to store energy in the form of an electromagnetic field surrounding the coil, which is made of a superconducting material. At very low temperatures, some materials lose every electric resistance, that means there is zero resistance, and thus it behave superconducting nature. The superconducting magnetic storage system makes use of this phenomenon and stores energy without almost any energy loss. Why? Because it shows zero resistance to the flow of energy. Because of zero resistance, its energy loss is zero. Maybe practically not zero, but theoretically the energy loss is zero in superconducting energy storage system. However, since relevant superconducting materials are only known to work to be low, at minus 253 degrees centigrade, so such a very low temperatures only it is possible for superconducting storage technology. This can be accomplished by liquefying helium. So in order to achieve this technology results, we need to use liquid helium, but it is very expensive, and the process lowers the efficiency, especially in standby mode. New high temperature superconductors have been in developing since 1980s, reaching the state of superconductivity already at minus 163 degrees centigrade. That means some temperature is raised to reach the superconducting temperatures. Known production methods for these materials, however, make them very brittle and difficult and expensive to process. This kind of technology, superconducting technology, is used in bullet trains. We can also called as maglev trains, which is used in, I think in Japan we are using for high speed trains, they are using this kind of technology, maglev trains. but it is very expensive technology. And also coming to the positives and negatives of this technology, coming to the positives, fast respond times, capable of partial and deep discharges, no environmental hazard. So with this technology, there is no harmful to the environment, and it is very fast. It responds very fastly. And coming to the negatives, high energy losses, because in standby mode we almost lost most of the energy. So in this way we have so much energy loss, and also it is very expensive in production and also in terms of maintenance, and reduced the efficiency due to the required cooling process. As we all know, this is a cooling process, so we need to use liquid helium to lower the temperature. It is very, very expensive technology to store the energy, but it has some very good advantages to use, like maglev trains, such a technologies. One of the energy storage technology is batteries, which is the process is very similar to the supercapacitor. So here we are not going in details of how they are working, how the performance increase. We are not going that much deep, but here we are explaining, we need to know something very base fundamentals about batteries and supercapacitors. So generally a battery is a device that produces electrical energy from chemical reactions. There are different kinds of batteries with different chemicals. The idea behind them is that the two different chemicals within a battery cell have different loads and are connected with a negative, which is also known as cathode, and the other with a positive electrode, which can be called as anode. When these anode and cathode connected to an appliance, the negative electrode supplies a current of electrons that flow through the appliance and are accepted by the positive electrode. For the use of storing energy produced by the renewable energy sources, only rechargeable batteries are relevant and will be considered. This is the fundamental construction strategy of the battery. We need an anode, that means positive electrode, and cathode, negative electrode. We need to connect them in order to convert chemical energy into electrical energy. In the above figure, we can observe the batteries, that means the cells connected in series. The battery consists of 6 2-volt cells connected in series, and in each cell we can observe the below figure. Each component cell is composed of several negative and positive electrodes made of pure spongy lead and lead oxide respectively. The electrodes connected in parallel are immersed in a dilute solution of sulfuric acid. This is a lead acid battery structure. Actually, in batteries we have different kinds of batteries available in the present society. because we need different kinds of efficiencies in order to achieve our purpose. And also in the improvement of batteries, we have our journey from lead acid batteries to right now we are doing research on lithium sulfur batteries. The journey of batteries is very long and improving every year by year. Lead acid batteries, it is one of the basic and oldest battery. The lead acid battery is the oldest known type of rechargeable battery and was invented in 1860. Even though the concept is 150 years back old, still the lead acid battery is very good for its cost effectiveness today. And the concept of lead acid battery has several in series connected cells, each delivering 2 volts, for example, each consisting several spongy pure lead cathodes, positive loaded lead oxide anodes, and 20-40% solution of sulfuric acid that acts as an electrolyte. When discharged, both the anode and cathode undergo a chemical reaction with the electrolyte that progressively changes them into lead sulfate that releases electrical energy in the process. This reaction can be almost completely reversed by supplying the electrodes with electricity, which is the reason a lead acid battery can be recharged. The cycle life and ability to tolerate deep discharges depending on the type. Coming to the positives and negatives of lead acid battery, it is easy and therefore cheap to produce. And it is very good technology, it is a mature technology, more than 150 years of experience and development. Very high surface to weight ratio, capable of delivering a high electricity at once, which is why they are so suitable as car starters. We can observe lead acid batteries in our cars to start the engine. And also it is easily recyclable. Similar to the advantages, there are some disadvantages. Here we can observe it is very heavy and bulky and short lifetime. Some environmental concerns, although pretty safe, lead is very toxic. Lead acid batteries, we are using lead oxide. We all know that lead is very toxic and exposure can cause severe damage to people and animals. And also it was corroded easily due to the chemical reactions of lead oxide. Lithium ion batteries. Nowadays, every electronic gadget is using lithium ion batteries. The concept of lithium ion batteries is lithium is the lightest metal with the highest potential due to its very reactive behavior. It makes it very fitting as a compound for batteries. For batteries, we need a lightest material. That's why lithium is one of the best choice for making batteries. Just as the lead acid and other batteries, the lithium ion battery by definition uses chemical reactions to release electricity. Although all are called lithium ion batteries, there is a variety of types with slightly different chemical compounds. The construction looks somehow similar to a capacitor using three different layers in order to minimize space. The first layer acts as anode and is made of lithium compound. The second one is the cathode and is usually made of graphite carbon material. Between anode and cathode, there is a third layer that is called separator, which separates anode and cathode. And also, even though it separates anode and cathode, the separator allows lithium ions to pass through the separator itself. The separator can be made of various compounds, allowing different characteristics and with that different benefits and flaws. In addition to the three layers are submerged in an organic solvent, the electrolyte. The three layers, cathode, anode, and separator, are merged in electrolyte because the lithium ions travels through separator via electrolyte, allowing the ions to move between the anode and cathode. In lithium ion batteries or in any battery, we will observe charging and discharging. In lithium ion batteries, now we will discuss about the charging mechanism. In charging process, the lithium ions pass through the microporous separator into spaces between the graphite carbon material, receiving an electron from the external power source. I am repeating, in charging process, the lithium ions pass through the separator into spaces between the graphite, receiving an electron from external power source. Coming to discharge process, during the discharge process, the lithium atoms located between the graphite release its electrons again that migrates over the external circuit to the anode, providing a current. The lithium ions move back to the anode as well, parallel to their released electrons. Because lithium is a very reactive compound and can burn into flames, safety measures have to be included. We could not work lithium in open air. We need to work in closed environment with inert gas atmosphere. So this is the charging and discharging mechanism of a lithium ion battery. And this is very similar and it is very useful to the present day devices. Lithium ion rechargeable battery charging and discharging mechanism. Coming to the advantages and disadvantages of lithium ion batteries, It has highest energy density in commercial available batteries with huge potential. And also it provides higher voltages per cell. That is 3.7 volt when compared to 2.2 volt for lead acid batteries. And also low energy loss, only about 5% per month. That means it is the energy loss in lithium ion battery is very low when compared with lead acid, because lead acid has corrode problem, and though so the energy loss is more in lead acid batteries. And lithium and graphite as resources are available in large amounts, and graphite is a carbon material, and also lithium resources are available in large amounts in our environment. The negatives of lithium ion batteries is it is very expensive. Complete discharge destroys the cell, so we should not discharge completely. Deteriorates even if unused, so if we are not used, so it will, the efficiency will be decreased. And the most dangerous thing is lithium is flammable in contact with atmospheric moisture. So these are the disadvantages that we have with lithium ion batteries. So far in this class we discussed about the energy sources which are available to us in nature, and also we discussed about how the energy will be converted from one form to another form, and we also discussed about energy conversion technologies, we discussed several kinds of energy conversion technologies and their efficiencies also we discussed, and we also discussed about energy storage technologies available to us, and we also discussed about several energy conversion devices. Especially we discussed about batteries, lead acid batteries, and also we discussed about lithium ion batteries and their advantages and disadvantages. We discussed in this class in detail. In our next class we will discuss about introduction to supercapacitors. I think this topic may take two classes, because we need to know in details of supercapacitors, how the supercapacitors evolved, and what are the basics, what are the history, and what are the milestones. So we will discuss about very basic fundamentals, so that we can understand clearly about the supercapacitors, and then we will discuss about the basic definitions and basic terms involved in the field of supercapacitors. And so we will discuss in our next class, we will go to the directly our topic, supercapacitors. So if you have any doubts, you can contact me through my mail. And this is our lecture class, Energy Conversion Engineering, week 2. In our next class, we will directly discuss about our main topic, supercapacitors. Thank you.